Fans, welcome to Studio Scale Star Trek Klingon Bird of Prey Project Update number 14. And it's going along, as they say, swimmingly well. The cool thing right now is both the wings are done. One of the laser cannons I'm still working on. But it really shows you the center body's only got the, the background color, the, what I call the underlay color of the, very, very bright sublime green, which is used as an accent, as an undertone for the main coloring. And the center body part now is the only thing that's still that way, still stark with that one layer. So it will really give you a really great concept of how far we've come on other sections. You know, like a layered sort of historical view of it before it gets completely done. Now, we're moving on to the center body, and that'll be the last of that video you'll see. So I think it's going to be a really good, what you call an interim video, show you a major step to another major step kind of progression. Otherwise, let's see what's going on. I did find some fabric. Klingon style, Klingon emblem fabric for the base, that sort of like a pyramid top cut off base. Elliot Brown from fedoratron.com is producing the frames for the backlit screens, which have blinking LEDs and things like that. I did offer the client a choice of LCD screens where they have loops running of films. But he chose to go simpler, which is fine. You know, I mean, it's a lot more money when you start to have to talk about, you know, LCD screens and the loop video systems and all that. And so I will be upholstering that on there. Yes, I used to do upholstery work when I was a scenic and set designer. So, yes, I do know how to do that. And once in a while, I actually upholster something in the house. Don't tell mommy. I'm also thinking about for the very top part where the pole goes through, maybe a Klingon emblem or something like that. Maybe else that Elliot Brown can cast for me. He doesn't know about that yet, but once he watches the video, he probably will. And it's something that will have a center hole cut out for it. Now, what I did find is I wanted to do Klingon symbols on the stock and all that. But they tend to be a very pointy thing, sharp, and I don't want, you know, the customer bleeding upon delivery. And boy, is it hot here already. It's close to the 90s. I know. It's only May, early May, and here in Florida, summer is coming. So what I did find is, oddly enough, I was thinking, how about some kind of conduit or hose look? And sure enough, the other day, one of my shop vacs died on me. And the hose, you know, with the ribbing and all that, was left behind, and I was like, wait a minute, what if I rust treated it and metal sort of like affected it, and it was like a lead conduit to the ship? And sure enough, it's a very cool look, and I think we're gonna go with that, because the ship has plenty of Klingon insignias and all that, and the screens below in the pyramid style base will have all sorts of good stuff. Now, Joe Rilat, who is like excellent at doing graphics and all that, he's the guy who did the L-cars back here, he's going to do the Klingon displays that are rear lit inside Elliot Brown's frames. See, I know all these people, and I know who does what best, and I can layer it per talent. And that's the great joy of being in this business for, you know, over 15 years now, is I've gotten to know everybody that's good at what they're good at. Everybody has a specific thing. Like, I'm a model builder. I'm not an engineer. I'm not a caster or anything like that. I just put it all together. And I've been lucky enough being in the business to know who does what and bring all their talents together. So it very much is a team effort. You know, I will take the credit for putting it all together and making a beautiful display, but I didn't do all of it. I did the shit, but all those little accents and things are other people, and I give them full credit whenever I can. Sometimes I forget because I forgot to take out the garbage. Ask my wife. Anyway, so what we got going, I'm going to show you the ship, which is wow, you know. The more I work on it, the more amazing it becomes. Steve Nyson, big points for making a fabulous, fabulous model. Really, just gorgeous. And I was missing a belly plate. There was only a few parts missing. And when you're talking about a kit that has this many little greebles and accents, it's not unusual for a part to be missing. What sucks is when somebody isn't prompt about getting you those parts or altogether doesn't get them to you and you've got a scratch build them, which I run into. But in his case, he got me the parts promptly, and thank you, Steve. I really appreciate that. Behind me here is Doug Cowles, who finally was acknowledged as an assistant modeler here. He's done a few projects for me. When somebody doesn't require a lighting, static model, and I don't have time for it, I happen to know that Doug does just as nice a work as I do. He may not get technically as much into it as I do and all that, although he is getting better all the time. Doug has my full faith, and he always sends me the kit first to make sure it's up to spec, and so far I have not been disappointed. As a matter of fact, in my collection are several of Doug's pieces because he is a great builder. And this is a Stargate display that he did for me that is on the website. It's got a couple spots showing up, but right now there's quite a bit of light in here. With the characters and everything. It did arrive damaged, unfortunately, so some of these lock components on the Stargate I had to redo, but you couldn't tell. And I added some decals here and there. But Doug is always ready to build something if I'm overflowed, and it's a static piece and it doesn't require a whole lot of lighting and all that. I will turn it over to Doug. And my clients are not disappointed. I don't think any one of them has ever been disappointed. And here is Tamiya masking heaven, because this kid is sucking up Tamiya tape like there's no tomorrow. And you'll see why, because of course, you know, 6 foot spread, boy, am I using up that tape. What else? I guess that's about it. Things are going well here. Jack's the new Wonder Puppy. Sorry, Steve. Is doing really, really well. He's very happy. We're foster parents. We don't plan on giving him up anytime soon. As a matter of fact, we've told her, Laura Ortiz of Great Dogs, and they have local chapters in your city, that we'd be happy to take on one or two fosters temporarily as they drift through and get adopted. Because of the fact that we have a very nice large property, I just wanted to have my own dog because, you know, it's just an emotional need. Some people don't like animals. I love animals, and I find them to be sometimes superior. God, it's hot in here already. Good Lord. I'm going to cut it short. And that was in winter when I'm wearing the the bear hat because it was darn cold. What am I doing? Oh, that's the Excelsior project I'm talking about. So, I guess we'll move on to the Klingon Bird of Prey and give you a look. And it really is amazing to see. So, let's move on. All right, so here's our big bird. Now, I'm going to get in some closer shots, but from there, you could probably see the starkness, the difference between a textured section and a non-textured section. This has still the underlay color. The underlay color being something that pronounces the color above it and gives it sort of a depth. It's actually an old trick from kindergarten, if you really want to know. I don't know if you remember, I went to parochial school, Catholic school. And what they did is they made us do a whole lot of blotches of colors and all that. And this was in watercolor. And then put black all over it. And then with the scratching implement, scratch over it, and then you would get that sort of like, you know, multicolored effect under the dark. Well, this is really just a more evolved version of that particular technique. A lot of people used it. I'm not going to name any names as far as famous artists, but I do know it was used throughout history as far as an art technique. So what we're going to do now is this particular cannon here, the port, has been completed. I'm going to move on to the starboard next after this update is filmed. And also remember that everything is done in stages. I like to pick a segment or a section and work on it and then go forward to another one. Go segment by segment. It's very mathematical. And that prevents you from getting a little too helter-skelter or having one thing kind of like overpower another or some paint spraying on something else. Masking is very important. Be precise in your masking. If you think, oh, that won't show up and all that, you know what? If you're doing spraying and airbrushing and all that, it'll be dead obvious, okay? Especially with bright colors. And using weathering to cover up mistakes, don't do that. Because it's pretty obvious that you over-darkened it and all that. I did that a couple times by accident. And sure enough, the thing came out so dark, I was really, really not happy with it. Even though it was still good. That's not the way to deal with an error. You deal with an error by segmenting it off that section, taping it up, doing it over again. Hopefully you still have the colors. You'll notice that I label my colors, and I've done some videos about that, showing you. You mark your colors, you label each one, and you know what you have, and you have a storage of some colors that later on, if you need touch-up, that you use, okay? So, you know, be intelligent about it. Don't expect to be able to goof through it, because especially on a project like this, it's not going to happen. And even on smaller projects, it's not going to happen, okay? So the wings are done. The wings are done here. The cannon's done here. But this is still very raw. So I'm going to come in closer and show you just how different when you finally apply those other secondary colors for the primary application. God, it gets complicated. But there is a technique. And see what the difference really is. And it's very obvious, and you'll see what I mean. So let's move on. All right, so here's a very good example of what I'm talking about. Now, the wing here on this side is not totally completed. This hasn't been done in lime green yet because it was sublime green. It got an application of pale green. And now I'm still waiting on the paints for that because I've used up my paints quite quickly. This is a big project and it's sucking up paints and tape like you wouldn't believe. But here's the harsh difference. Notice this is the original sublime green underlay color. Then you progress down. This is sort of in between. And here's final application minus weathering. We're not done with weathering on this wing yet. Okay, the weathering really will bring out those red accents and all that. This is sort of the semi-finished tableau to do that with. Let me move a little bit more. And, oh, the gray stripes on these gridded patterns is done. Let me move a little bit more and show you the cannon. Moving on. All right, so here's the port cannon. Now, do you note these cannons do go up and down and sideways? Very cool little option. This is sort of what I was looking for. I think it's more copper than this. There's a little tiny bit of dust fawning on it. I was just playing around. There's your gray stripe. There's your multicolored tile. Of course, the conduits will all be painted silver, and the conduits aren't in there yet. They're three-dimensional conduits. Now, what I do use is oil-based pastels. I mean, it doesn't totally replace airbrush work, but when you start to get into like very defined details and some rust, you know, droplet effects and things like that, I highly recommend oil-based pastels. And you can order those anywhere. As far as reference material, my God, other than my friend in Ireland who sent me this terrific book, holy Jesus, as I go from step to step to step, I've got the book on material. Not only is this Steve Nice and stuff, this is also Frank Scale Modeling. Holy crap. All kinds of things. And I'm going to hang on to this because if I ever have to build this again, this is certainly a treasure trove of material. But notice the gun, from what I can make out, this is a gray stripe. However, it's got a lot of rust effects. You'd swear it's basically all rust, and it probably will be by the time I'm done. All this stuff has a lot of rust effects. But again, I'm making it my own. It's not exactly like anybody else's. I like to do things with a certain personal touch. And certainly by the time I'm done, it will be mine. Let's take another look, moving on. And here it really, really is obvious with that underlay color. And look, over here is where we're starting to get into the more defined aspects of it. So what's still left here is that red cloaking device bar, which will be going on the end. There's a few parts that are going on the end, and I've said that. Oops, scratchy. things happen while you're building. There's a lot of detail in the neck part underneath here. I've noticed today while I was watching a film that the grill here has some silver accents. This is yet to be painted. These will be a blackish, rustish color. This has several panels. And I finally did get in. It wasn't what I thought it was. I thought it was Russian blue, but it ended up being another color altogether. And I'm looking. What's it called? There it is. It's actually one of the in-between blue colors. Is interior blue-green. I thought it was Russian blue, but Russian blue turned out to be grayish, which is this. This is Russian blue. And although that looks accurate and all that, I may be going over it with this. I prefer a more colorful look. And for you guys keeping up with this, this is number 2135. And it is called interior blue green. And that is one of the colors I think is vital to bringing this thing to life, especially towards here in the front and all that. That's that turquoisey color you were looking at. And a couple of the stripes here, this is silver. And there's quite a few greybles yet that I haven't added, but I told you I want to paint those afterwards. Take the time to do it in step. All right, so let's see. Let's move on to another angle. And then we can call this film a wrap. And yes, probably not the longest film I've ever done. But hey, if I'm over 15 minutes, I'm happy. Okay, moving on. Okay, again, a really good perspective shot to give you an idea of the difference between a semi-completed case without weathering and a raw piece that has just had one layer put on it. And you can see Edward Holt's wonderful mechanism. And I believe Edward's going to be offering those for sale, probably on my store page as well as whatever own page he has. I'm not proprietary or anything like that, whatever he likes to do, but I will definitely recommend this motor for this kit, as well as for other kits. I mean, if you've got a serious size kit that needs a motor drive, Edward's the guy to go see. What else? Let's see. Oh! And the red shirt you see me wearing with the, let's see if I can get it in there. Ooh, the Kit Factory logo. If I get any closer, there you go. These are the red shirts, also known as the death shirts. I may be adding them to the website. Depends how the people on Facebook react. But security team shirts, notice that all my shirts have been command color, science color, and now security colors. To sort of keep it on a Star Trek-ish level. Star Wars has too many colors. I can't keep up with that. So next, what we'll be doing is going to the upper body, the main body, the head unit, or the bubble butt, as I got to call it. Oh, the butt. I made somebody happy. I know I did. And then by the third pass, notice this hasn't been grayed yet. Been working mostly on the port side. We're going to start seeing this thing really come to life. And when those baffles go in and I turn everything back on and wire up the electronics, it's going to be quite a show. And then we'll start showing you the updates on the pyramid base, which let's take a look at real quick and then wrap up the film. Moving on. Okay, so here's our pyramid base, which was made by my good neighbor Doug. Now, this is what I was talking about. It's basically, this is not the piece I'm going to use, but sort of what I'm thinking about using. And slips over the rod really nicely. And I was thinking of rust and steel effects on it as a detail, and then having a Klingon emblem right here on the top part, which I'm going to talk to Elliot about, or he'll be talking to me about it pretty soon. And that's sort of the concept for the lead-in for it. Now, the pole right now is still very herky-jerky because inside it will be this receptor plate, which will keep everything nice and lined up. Now, on this side is our access door, where I'll be able to install things as in the power bar, the electronics, and once the screens are cut out, their rear lighting effects. And Doug has beautiful woodwork. This is actually pretty raw because it's going to be an upholstered piece. And there's a Klingon fabric, canvas-style fabric that has all the little Klingon Empire symbols done in a repeating pattern. And we'll be using that and then cutting out sections for these screens. So even though I know right now it looks like, well, that's death. Well, wait till you see what it's done. And it is on a rolling base. And the geometry of it basically is that it's very steady on its wheels and it will not overturn the model itself, which is extremely heavy. So that about wraps up update 14. I'm sorry we have company coming over and I don't have time for a funny this week. So forgive me, but next week we'll have a funny. Take care, Papa Smurf out.